What is going on, everybody? It's the Fountain. We're here for Unscripted SmackDown review for January 17th, 2020. This, of course, is the... We're 1 week away from the Royal Rumble. This was just, you know, continuation getting into the Royal Rumble. We had multiple matches announced. Two stipulations out of two matches already announced. And a little bit more. The show started off with everyone's not-so-favorite demon, Kane. We're all wondering, why is Kane here? What is Kane doing on SmackDown? What does he have to do with SmackDown tonight, last night? And I was not happy with the fact that they had him on for a minute. His promo sucked, but when it came down to the end of it, it actually made sense. Of course, as we know, Daniel Bryan is taking on The Fiend at the Royal Rumble. Daniel Bryan and Kane, of course, were Team Hell No for about 2 years or so. They made a return in 2018, was it? They had the Team Hell No for a pay-per-view. So this was all just a ploy for Daniel Bryan to get one up on The Fiend. So Kane's out there, he's cutting a promo talking about the Royal Rumble. I was expecting him to say that I am officially entering myself into the Royal Rumble. Didn't get time to say that. Out comes the Firefly Funhouse comes on. And you have Bray Wyatt talking about how I will never forget you and neither will he, showing flashbacks of the Ring of Fire match. Let's not even talk about that match. That match sucked. But showing why The Fiend is going after Kane. I don't know, because I still don't know why that, because Kane lost that Ring of Fire match and then they went off to do whatever with him. But the lights go down. Let's go back up. Kane's outside the ring. The Fiend comes up through the ring, crawls to the ropes, sticks his tongue out, looks like he's looking all menacing and everything. Kane turns around and says, "Took you long enough. But what took you so long?" The Fiend just looks confused, so it's confused you can with a mask on. Turns around, boom, running knee. Daniel Bryan with a couple of stomps to that, like grabs his arse, then starts stomping on the face as he's done multiple times before. The Fiend tries to escape back through the ring, but Bryan is still fighting him, crawling at him. Bryan comes back up with a handful of those fake ass dreadlocks that the Fiend wears. As The Fiend did with him a couple weeks ago, and Bryan stands tall, so red lights as a yes chant starts up. Bryan looks around and joins. Kane comes back into the ring and starts doing the yes chant as well. Team Hell No does the chant together, and that was that. So, good opening segment in the whole. I was like, why is Kane here? Is he going to introduce himself into the Royal Rumble? What is going on? It went from, ugh, this sucks, to, well, that makes sense why they would bring Kane out. Kane was here to set up The Fiend for Daniel Bryan. I have no problem with that. That was absolutely one of the best ways they could have used Kane in this situation. Have him come out there, draw The Fiend out, get Daniel Bryan to come out, boom, knee, couple stomps, couple punches, tear out some of the fake dreadlocks, and go from there. Back when we go to break, we come back, and Caleb Braxton stops Daniel Bryan. Bryan says, a lot of people think The Fiend is good at mind games and getting the best of people, but what he's really good at is running away. Bryan asks how he can beat someone who disappears every time they're in trouble. He's got an idea. It's not a good idea, it's not a really smart idea, but he challenges The Fiend to a strap match. Bryan says that we will have each end of the strap and go to war until one man wins. Bryan talks about how he understands what can happen to him, but he's done with these mind games and The Fiend escaping down the hole every time he gets in trouble. Bryan says The Fiend changed him, but at the Royal Rumble, he will change The Fiend and win the Universal Championship. This is interesting. I did not see a strap match coming. I've seen maybe a cage match. Maybe a false count anywhere match, but we'll get to that later. Strap match, if you asked me if they were going to put a stipulation on this match, what is the one match that you would not expect? And I don't even think I would think of a strap match. So this is going to be interesting, and it's just funny that the Royal Rumble is going to be more extreme in this match, in the Roman Reigns and Baron Corbin match, which we'll get to later, then Extreme Rules will be at all this year. I'm counting that on right now. Big E takes on John Morrison after we come back from break. This, of course, is a follow-up to what happened last week between The Miz and Kofi Kingston, as John Morrison took out Big E on the outside with that crazy jump over flip, taking him down. But before we get to the match, Kofi Kingston, what did you do to your hair? This dude comes out every week, black hair, you know, it's black hair, braided up and everything, or it's whatever they call that style, with a little bit of yellow blonde strip in it. This mofo came out with nothing but blonde hair. This dude blonded himself all the way. And I was like just sitting there watching, and I was like, what the hell did you do to yourself, Kofi? Weird to see this dude coming out like that. Matt Morrison did come out. He got his first match back. They did do the slow-mo, pyro, wavy hair stuff. So he got that one. So these guys are having themselves a good match. Big E, of course, overpowering John Morrison because he's a freaking tank. Morrison using his parkour abilities to try and stay ahead of the game with Morrison. We get closer to the end of the match, and Morrison's up on the top turnbuckle. Kofi's on the outside. So Morrison, who has Big E down, instead of doing something to Big E, decides to take a flip and take out Kofi Kingston on the outside. This, of course, infuriates Big E. Probably not a good idea to do that, but Big E charges the ropes. Looks like he's going to spear the daylights out of Morrison, but Miz pushes him away and gets him out of there. Big E reaches for the Miz, but gets dropped with a kick by Morrison. Morrison comes back in, drops Big E with a knee, goes up the corner, hits the Starship Pain, 1, 2, 3. Now, you think being gone for 8 years, Morrison could have came out with a new finisher. He used Starship Pain everywhere else I know, but you figured it's been 8 years, hardly anybody in the crowd knows who you are. Couldn't you come out with something different? Starship Pain is just a lazy man's spinal tap. It's not a good move. I don't like the Starship Pain. I've never liked the Starship Pain. I think it's stupid. But hey, it got John Morrison the win. Now let's just talk about Baron Corbin. We'll pick the stipulation in the Rumble match with Roman Reigns if Robert Roode wins tonight. Table match over Roman Reigns. Reigns will pick the stipulation of Corbin if he wins tonight. Last night. Now, it's funny because you had, after this match was over with and they're celebrating, you have, let's go to the commentator's desk, and they're tweeting this as if it was breaking news, as if they didn't know this going into the show, even though I'm pretty sure I read earlier in the day the stipulation was added about, like, 2 or 3 in the afternoon. So why, oh why, does they have to treat it as if it was breaking news? So stupid. So effing stupid. Usos versus Revival. We get this match, and I'm like, okay, this could be cool. Oh, they were in the back for a minute. We had the Usos backstage formally ask about the stipulation for the Rumble, but he says he will find out when everyone else does. Rowan says he's been training in the yard, but he wonders if the Usos are ready for when they have in store. They are hyped up for the Revival and walk off to the match. They say welcome, and then they walk off, and then it just focuses on Rain. He's like, to the Uso Penitentiary. Not as cool when Roman says it. Not as cool. Back from break, the announcers plug the Xbox NFL, which was going to have the Packers and the Niners this coming Sunday. So go check that out if you want to watch some football. And then they congratulate Jimmy Johnson for being put into the Football Hall of Fame, as he is a colleague, now technically a colleague of theirs, because they all work for Fox. So we had the Usos versus the Revival. When this match was announced, I'm like, okay, this could be good. This could be really good, and the match didn't last more than 5 minutes. This match was the Revival pretty much getting beat pillar to post, and the Usos just doing whatever they wanted to the Revival and making the Revival look like shit. Jimmy tags in, Jay runs the ropes, nails a suicide dive to Dawson King. Will someone please tell me why one of these, because back before they left and went on their merry way for a minute, you could tell the difference between the Usos, because one would wear shirts and the other one wouldn't. So you could tell, oh, if Jimmy's got the shirt on, then that's Jimmy, and if it's Jay, then it's Jay. Now they're not, and I can't tell the difference between either one of these two, so I can't tell you. If I write down Jimmy is because that's what they said. I can't tell the difference between either one of these guys. Big splash, Uso splash on the Dawson for the pin and the win, Uso's win. Reigns and Roode later in the night, back for break, and then WWE touts the social media milestone of 20 million Instagram followers. Now, anybody who knows anything about Instagram and anything about social media and whatnot, WWE's main account does not have 20 million Instagram followers. They are counting everybody who is a WWE employee, anybody who has any association with WWE. I guarantee they even count John Cena, The Rock, any of those guys. If there is a person who is in the WWE who has an Instagram account, they count that as being WWE's Instagram. Like, they have over 20 million Instagram followers, not WWE itself. So I really don't care about that number. I don't think anyone should really care about that number. But this is WWE for you, just trying to do everything they can to make it look like they are bigger than they are. When Vivon walking backstage, when Kayla stops them and they ask if they're frustrated with another loss, Dawson says that this company won't make a change for them, then the Revival have to make some kind of change. Dawson says something similar. We hear a fight happening in this backstage arena, and the camera jumps to Lacey Evans beating up Sasha Banks, and watch, Sasha Banks is down. Banks is down and looks to hurt. And Bayley makes the save and tends to Banks while these two are brawling. We got talent. We got agents backing off Lacey Evans. Is Sasha Banks legitimately hurt? Because this is 2 weeks in a row that they have kept her from wrestling a match against Lacey Evans. I know maybe Lacey Evans doesn't deserve to be in the same ring as Sasha Banks, but of course, this, if she's not injured, this is just being used as a way to get her to take on, make a, so they can get the title match at the Royal Rumble, because, you know, WWE cannot do anything else creative other than, let's have the champion get beat in a non-title match. That's going to justify a title match. Now let's look at the recent happenings between Mandy Rose and Otis. We see Rose and Sonya Deville backstage. Rose is excited about Deville's match and says, Rose, Deville was right last week. This is the year of fire and desire. Sonya asks if Rose thinks Otis might want to be at ringside for her match tonight. Rose asks why, because Rose will be at ringside. Sonya says she didn't get the Otis thing before, but after seeing him out there helping Rose win last week, she gets it. Rose isn't seeing the Otis thing. Now Deville is confused. Deville just wants Rose to ask if he will be at ringside. She doesn't know, but to ask him, of course Deville says, if you ask him, I'm pretty sure he will be. I guess the whole Mandy Rose is supposed to be blind thing is a thing. So, yeah, Mandy Rose, Sonya Deville. Obviously, Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville are going to be broken up by the end of this year. They're going to have Otis be the wedge between Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville. It's kind of obvious. Bayley and Sasha Banks are in the trainer's room. Banks is at an ankle. Bayley is furious and threatens to turn Lacey Evans into a stay-at-home mom. When WWE producer Adam Pearce shows up and comments on Banks failing to deliver a match once again that they have promoted 2 weeks in a row, he says, well, the match is still official, but Bayley is taking your place. And Bayley's like, I'm not putting it on the line. She doesn't deserve a title match. And Adam Pearce is like, of course not. But it's happening. Pearce walks off and goes commercial. They are not happy with the ruling. So, is Adam Pearce the de facto general manager? This is not the first time we've seen him be used as somewhat of an authority figure to help make stipulations or talk about. Here's an idea. Just make Adam Pearce the general manager of SmackDown. How hard is that? You just make Adam Pearce the general manager of SmackDown. You have just turned him into continuity. You had Bayley mention Sasha Banks say his name. You had fucking Michael Cole say Adam Pearce. Just make him say, your new general manager of SmackDown, WWE agent Adam Pearce. Why the hell not? He's already doing that role as we see. So just make it happen. Then we get Bayley and Lacey Evans. This was a match. This was an okay match. This was basically WWE's excuse that we have no other creative way to go. So we're going to have Lacey Evans get into a title match against Bayley at the pay-per-view by having her beat Bayley. You couldn't have, I don't know, Dana Brooke and Lacey Evans have a feud. You couldn't have Carmella versus Lacey Evans. The winner goes up against Bayley. No, we're just going to have Lacey Evans go out there and beat the champion. And when I say beat the champion, Evans shows in the corner. Bayley drops her face first with a turnbuckle. Bayley looks capitalized, but out of nowhere, boom, women's right. And it looked great live, but once you went to replay, you can definitely see that she missed as much as she could. But 1, 2, 3, and Lacey Evans is your winner. So yes, at the Royal Rumble, it will be Lacey Evans versus Bayley for the SmackDown Women's Championship. That's lazy booking, in my opinion. So that is that. Alish Ashton, a new backstage interviewer for SmackDown, is talking to Chad Gable. I refuse to reference him, that awful nickname. She asked why Sheamus returned to single him out. Gable says Sheamus games won't work on him and says the same goes for attacking him while he's down. Gable goes on about embracing yourself and knows Sheamus is big and is decorated, but Sheamus say, hey, has anyone seen Chad Gable? Of course, he said what they're calling him now. Sheamus face off with him now. Goes, oh, there you are. They talk trash. Sheamus threatens to knock his head off again and pats him on the head, calling him little fella. And all of a sudden, Gable attacks him. They start brawling. Brawl is broken up, but Sheamus is fuming as he destroys some stuff backstage. And we go back to commercial break. I am sick and tired of the Chad Gable being disrespected and having to do this. I would love to have Chad Gable in a room with no cameras, no nothing, and ask him face to face, do you actually enjoy this entire disrespectful short joke gimmick? It's disrespectful to him, it's disrespectful to all short people. It's only funny to Vince McMahon. Ha ha ha, he's shorty, this is good shit. It's not. It is not at all. Like I said, go back to the King of the Ring. Go back to every single match after that first one. And Chad Gable went from a little over to very over. And then what happened? They changed his name to Shorty Gable, then Shorty this. And it's just awful. It's just absolutely some of the worst television you will ever see. I am tired of seeing it. I know everyone else is tired of seeing it. Give me a freaking break. This is just too much. So people are asking, is all of his feuds going to be about height? Of course they are. His name is Shorty. His nickname starts with the word Shorty. It's all going to be about his height. And it's funny how he says, when you accept who you are, so why are you lying to yourself, Chad? This is not you. You are not the advocate for short people. You are a former Olympian badass. That's who you are. And the fact that this is what you want to have your legacy known as is a guy who goes out there week in and week out being made fun of on national television just boggles my mind. This makes me shake my head that you don't actually like doing this, but you're doing it because it's what Vince McMahon wanted and it's what's going to pay your bills. You deserve better, fans deserve better, we all deserve better than this garbage. And speaking of this garbage, these two will be facing off against each other one-on-one at the Royal Rumble, because this is a match that should be at the Royal Rumble. Nah, the Intercontinental title should be at the Royal Rumble, the United States Championship should be at the Royal Rumble. Sheamus versus Chad Gable, a match that should be on SmackDown? Nah, that should not be nowhere near the Royal Rumble. Back from commercial, and Braun Strowman says he declares himself for the 30-man Rumble match. Says this that it is next week, and now he wants to talk about the Intercontinental Champion, Shinsuke Nakamura. He goes on about Sheamus, Nakamura, and Sami Zayn, and says he just wants his shot. He doesn't care if it's this week, next week. He wants his shot at Nakamura. I've beaten him twice. I don't know what else I have to do to get a title shot. Well, hell, Lacey Evans beats Bayley once and gets a title shot. What's stopping him? So, we come for the musical part of the afternoon. Elias, he learned about himself over the last year. He realized he's fooling Marty and WWE, but he realized he can't do it alone. And the truth is, he needs the fans. He says for him to reach where he belongs, he needs voices to ring out all over the world with the truth that WWE stands for. As they chant "Walk with Elias" twice, he starts performing his new song "Walking in Greensboro" because they were in Greensboro, North Carolina. When out comes Sami Zayn, I was wondering when these are going to start happening again because, as we know, you can't go in an Elias concert without somebody interrupting, and we haven't had an interruption, I believe, the last two times. Sami Zayn hates to interrupt him, but he, the Great Liberator, has something important to talk about. He knocks the fans and they boo him. Brings up how Braun Strowman is running around ranting about wanting to fight Nakamura. Sami says Nakamura doesn't back down from anybody. And Braun won't have to wait long for his answer because his answer is absolutely not. He rips Braun some more and says he's no position to demand anything because we call the shots around here. Sami says nothing will be happening with the Rumble 9 match 9 days away. He brags on how Nakamura has actually won the Royal Rumble. He warns the entire roster that they were all now on notice, and it's Cesaro and Nakamura being in the Rumble. Sami Zayn says he made his point and Elias can continue. Elias says he has multitasking while Sami spoke. Now he has a new song he just wrote in his head. It's called "Sami Needs to Shut His Mouth." The chorus goes "Shinsuke's Rock," so if you guys fans want to tune to help in, you just sing along. So he starts to play, and Sami Zayn interrupts him again, sends Cesaro down there to teach him a lesson. They brawl, Nakamura comes in, they brawl, Sami Zayn comes in, they all start beating him down. Out comes Braun Strowman. Of course, Sami retreats. Braun sends Nakamura over the top next and stands tall as he plays through the crowd. Fans cheer for Strowman as Sami, Cesaro, and Nakamura regroup. Strowman tells them to bring it as his music starts back up. So, waste of time, in my opinion. We get a tribute video for the recently passed away Rocky Johnson, who did pass away a couple days ago due to a blood clot. Rest in peace, Rocky Johnson. He was a trailblazer, and again, another one of those excellent video packages that WWE, only WWE, seems to know how to do. So fans cheer Rocky when we come out back from that, and then we go to commercial. Then we come back and it's Sonya Deville versus Alexa Bliss. Sonya Deville is out already. Mandy Rose. Out comes Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross. The match is about to begin when out comes Heavy Machinery. They watch from the bottom of the ramp as the bell rings. Sonya takes control early on and she does a big running kick. This match lasts about maybe 3 minutes. Bliss goes to grab Deville, but Rose comes to the top to interfere. Cross runs over and knocks Bliss off, but she knocks her into Otis, and Otis just catches her. He's got this look of desire on his face. She's like licking her lips. He's like, he's like flicking his tongue up and down. They look like, oh my God, it's just like, it's so believable, yet it's so like disturbing at the same time. Deville and everyone look at Otis holding Rose. They all smile. Bliss takes advantage of the distraction and rolls Rose up for one, Deville up for one, two, three, and Alexa Bliss wins the match. After the match, Bliss and Cross head to the stage. The music hits. Rose joins Deville in the ring to apologize for the distraction. Otis is on cloud nine. I don't. The only thing I can see this going to is that you're gonna get that ultimate heel moment where Mandy Rose absolutely breaks his heart, or they are going to do what I think they're going to do and break up Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville, Fire and Desire, because of Otis. But we were backstage with King Corbin and or Baron Corbin and Dolph Ziggler. I really don't care about this shit. They're hyping him up. What else can you say? In the strap match, stipulation confirmed for Bryan versus The Fiend, Sheamus versus Chad Gable, and Lacey Evans versus SmackDown Women's Champion Bayley for the title are confirmed for the Royal Rumble. And we go into the table match, Robert Roode versus Roman Reigns. I hate table matches. They're not exciting. All it is two guys trying to figure out a way to not put somebody through a table for about 15 to 20 minutes until it's time to put somebody through a table. Of course, towards the end of the match, Dolph Ziggler, Baron Corbin get involved, Usos get involved, Usos take out Dolph Ziggler on the announce table or doing the double Usos spear through the table. One, two, three. Roman Reigns wins. Did you think Roman Reigns was going to lose this match? Did you think Robert Roode was going to win this match? Absolutely not. After the bell, we see Corbin throwing a tantrum at the ringside like a little bitch. By the way, I didn't know this because I didn't know at the time, but I have a PSP emulator on my computer. And I grabbed a copy of Madden 12, and you can actually see a very young, still has hair, Tom Pescott, also known as Baron Corbin, on the Arizona Cardinals. So if you want to check out Madden 12, if you have a copy of that somewhere, yes, Baron Corbin is in Madden 12 under his real name, Tom Pescott. Just saying. Roman says Rumble was in a baseball stadium, and he's going to beat Corbin all over the... He announces that the match will be falls count anywhere. Corbin continues to rant and complain as Reigns celebrates and the Usos in the ring. SmackDown on Fox goes off the air. Whoop-dee-doo. I am so done with the whole Baron Corbin thing. I think it's time we're done with him. Why they continue to push Baron Corbin is beyond me. This guy brings absolutely nothing to the product. Hopefully this will be it. Honestly, what I think they should do for this match is it's a false count anywhere match. The winner goes to the Royal Rumble. The loser is out of the Royal Rumble. And that's what I would have done. So Baron Corbin can win, and then you can sit there and say, oh, Roman's not going to win the Rumble. But here's the thing. If Roman wins the match, I don't see he's not winning the Rumble. If Roman loses the match, he's winning the Royal Rumble. It's just that simple. If Roman beats Baron Corbin, he's not winning the Rumble. If he loses to Baron Corbin because of outside means, he's winning the Royal Rumble. All I know is if Roman Reigns wins the Royal Rumble this year, can they at least book it better than they did last time? You know, when Kane and Big Show came in there and just eliminated people so anticlimactically, you know, WND, and just tossing them out as if they were... What paper, they would sacks of dog shit. Only for The Rock to come down and help him take out these two guys. And then, of course, Rusev, everyone became a massive Rusev fan that night because they wanted to see Rusev beat anybody. But Roman to win that night would have been great in the company. But that's not what happened. So, yeah. SmackDown was okay. We got a strap match. Bayley versus... Lacey Evans not really caring about that. This is the problem with these matches where you had the champion lose to the challenger. You just saw that match on free TV. Why the hell would I want to see it at the Royal Rumble? That just boggles my mind. Why would I want to see that at the Royal Rumble if I just saw it yesterday? Same thing with Nakamura versus Braun Strowman. Why the heck would I want to see that match if I just saw it last week? There's got to be a better way of figuring out your number one contenders than having the champion lose, because what is the point of having the champion take on the challenger in a non-title match for having the champion lose just to have a match at the pay-per-view? It's a practice that needs to be ended. So... that is your SmackDown review for this week. Hit that subscribe button, comment down below, like or dislike this video. Find me on Twitter at The Fronts Club. Find me on twitch.tv/TheFrontsClub. And I'll see you guys tomorrow for another episode of Unscripted. Until then, my name is The Fronts, and I'll see you guys later.